said at first service, you know, you can run the Boston Marathon and then play the piano like that. It just doesn't seem fair, right? Yeah, that's amazing. Thank you, Becky. Last year, we've been in the second chapter of Ephesians. I hope that this has been, I hope it's been helpful to you. I hope it's been a growth time for you as we've been walking through this. Now, I just want to kind of back up and retrace our steps before we go forward, because, of course, all of this needs to be seen in context. And you'll remember we started in Ephesians chapter 2. We talked about the fact that we were dead in our trespasses and sins. In other words, we were separated from God because of trespasses and sins, spiritually dead. And we walked in those, it says, according to the course of this world, and according to the prince of the power of the air, and according to our own desires and our own ideas, our own wants and our own desires, our own flesh, as the Bible calls it. And this tells us that we were not only spiritually separated from God, but we were also in bondage to the world, the flesh, and the devil, as we say. And then, not only that, but we were under condemnation. We were children of wrath. Do you remember verse 4? What a tremendous word that is. But God, two words, but God is rich in mercy. And all those things, it helps us to understand that no longer are we spiritually separated from God. No longer are we in death. We have been made alive with Christ Jesus. We are no longer under bondage, but we have been set free. And we're no longer under condemnation. We're no longer children of wrath, but we have been seated in the heavens with Christ Jesus. And then last week we talked about the fact that all of this is by grace. The process that all of this, which all this happened and took place in our lives, is by grace you are saved through faith. It's a gift of God, not of works, the thing that we should boast. Nobody can say, look what I've done. All of us say it is by the grace, by the goodness of God. Nobody can brag about it. And not only has He saved us, but He has saved us unto good works. And last week we talked about the fact that we are made masterpieces. We are a masterpiece in God's hand. We've been created in Christ Jesus to do good works. So we're not saved by works, but we are saved to do good works, which God prepared beforehand for us to do. God ordained these things in your life and in my life. And so all of us stand just in awe before Him as we realize what He's done in our lives. But a lot of this that we've been talking about, we can kind of apply to us individually. And it's easy for us to sometimes interpret the Scripture, interpret the Bible, and think of it, what does this do for me? How does this change my life? And we as 21st, particularly American Christians, are really good at this, thinking about, okay, what does this mean for me? Tell me what it means to me. And we kind of lose sight of the fact that the Bible, the New Testament, was written to us, right? It was written to the church. It's not just written to you as an individual. Yes, you as an individual, but you as an individual, as a part of the whole of what God is doing in the world, His church. And so what we're going to see here is a real marked shift in that. As we talk about it, we're going to focus on this the next few weeks, because this whole idea of being included really carries on right on through into chapter 3. And just that one word, include, get that in your mind, include. And let's read these verses together. Ephesians 2, verse 11 following. Therefore, remember that at one time, you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands, remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated or excluded from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For He Himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in His flesh the dividing wall of hostility. All of us probably remember a time in our lives when we felt excluded. We felt like we were on the outside looking in. And maybe it was in your family. Maybe it was simply not being included on a team. Maybe you wanted so desperately to be a part of the in crowd. And maybe it was at a time in your life when you were just kind of down on yourself, and it wasn't so much what other people were doing, it's more what you felt and were experiencing inside of yourself. And, And the thing about that is there's something inside of us as human beings that wants to be included, right? That's just kind of universal. We want to feel like we fit in somewhere. And the bad thing is that we want so badly, we want so desperately to be included, that we'll run over other people to get there. We'll wall ourselves off with our little group so that we can feel more in. Even if it means we wall other people out. And this is a terrible part of our problem as human beings. As I thought about this week, I was just overwhelmed by what a struggle I find inside myself and what I see inside of all of us. As we fight this battle, this is a tremendous battle. This is one of the worst marks of the fall. One of the worst marks of our sin. We see it in Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. You remember, Adam and Eve, and if you read Genesis chapter 2, it says that God brought them together. God basically performing the first marriage, a man and woman brought together. And then it says at the close of chapter 2 that they were naked and they felt no shame. Now there it wasn't, I don't think it was just talking about the physical nakedness. But it was talking about the fact that that there was nothing that walled them off from each other. There was nothing that caused them to look at one another with anything but acceptance. And there was no disdain between them. There was no exclusion in them as they dwelt there in the Garden of Eden with each other. But in chapter 3 of Genesis, that awful moment in time and space when human beings turned against the very God who created us and rebelled against Him and tried to take life in our own hands, at that moment, not only was there separation from God, God warned them, if you eat of this one tree, if you do one little thing, I mean, one thing God told them, don't do this. They did it. And when they did, they found themselves separated from God. But not only were they separated from God, they were separated from each other. And they covered themselves. And all of a sudden you have, and you know, this thing between men and women is carried on ever since, right? But not just men and women. Between all of us. It is a non-respecter of persons. Across races, across people groups, across gender, across parties, across whatever. We all of us find ourselves right in the middle of this. And so and this is the way it's expressed in this passage. Paul uses words like separated, alienated, strangers. And when you begin to think about it, these are some of the worst words in the human language. Think about that. This is what we all dread, and we will do almost anything to keep it from happening to us. Almost anything to keep ourselves from feeling like we're on the outside looking in. And somewhere we'll find a crowd, even if it's a crowd that's self-destructive. Even if it's a crowd, because there's something inside of us that would almost rather be destroyed in a crowd than be walled off by ourselves. Today we're going to present the problem, and we're going to be looking at it over the next few weeks. And you can't really appreciate the solution until you understand the problem. But you know, it's like I said a few weeks ago, it's like trying to tell a child how much you love that child. It's like trying to tell a little child how much you've sacrificed for that child, to help that child, you know, to what you would do for that child. That child cannot grasp the sacrifice a parent makes for them. And I don't think we can fully grasp and appreciate what God has done for us through Christ. I don't think we can do that, but I hope we can at least scratch the surface. I hope we can maybe wound ourselves a little bit, enough to understand, to hurt with our sin, and to rejoice with the victory that is ours in Christ. Now, and so it starts verse 11, therefore remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision. Let me just stop right there, because that seems kind of confusing to us. And let me just tell you, the best way for us to understand that is to understand that that was a racial slur. The Jews considered themselves a walled-off people from all the rest of humankind. They considered themselves a superior people to all the rest of humankind. God had chosen them, but he had chosen them for a specific purpose. And they had used the fact that they were chosen by God as a way to make them feel somehow superior to everybody else. And instead of being a light to the Gentiles, they closed themselves off from the very people that God, the nations, God wanted to see his glory through them. And so they would call everybody who wasn't a Jew the uncircumcised. Now that seems kind of strange to us, but the circumcision was a sign of the covenant, the Abrahamic covenant. And you go back and read in the book of Genesis, and you see that God told Abraham to circumcise his son and to circumcise everyone in his household. All the males in his household were to be circumcised. And this was a sign of the covenant. It was an outward sign of what God wanted to be real in them. But obviously, just because there was outward circumcision didn't mean there was, as the New Testament says, circumcision of the heart. Just because there are outward things doesn't mean there are inward things, right? We all know that. You can put on and you can make it look good on the outside, even though it's pathetic on the inside. And that's exactly what was happening here. But it was a racial slur. They would say about every other nation, those uncircumcised Gentiles. And they believed that everybody who was an uncircumcised Gentile was good for nothing but death and hell. But just to be fair about it, and to be clear about it, and to understand this completely, what we need to understand is that this was not just the Jews. Okay? Paul continues this verse, which is made in the flesh by hands, to help them to understand that this was just outward. It was not inward. It was in the flesh by human hands. And then he speaks of those who are the circumcised, because the Greeks of the time, when Paul wrote this, considered themselves a superior race too. Isn't it amazing how we do that as human beings? You remember the thing that kind of ignited everything in Nazi Germany was this sense of superiority. And those who are not with us, not like us, are to be wiped out so we can build this superior race. And even though we kind of scoff at that, we all have this sense that in some form or fashion we're superior to other people around us. It really is an across-the-board struggle that we have. Just kind of illustrate that, the Greeks of Paul's time considered themselves a superior race. If you study Western civilization, you'll note that they, of course, Hellenism rose up and the Greek language became the language of, after Alexander the Great conquered the known world of that time, and they considered themselves to be the sophisticated elite, and anybody who was not a Greek, Cicero, representing all the Greeks, said was a barbarian. Everybody. Across the board. And the reason they called them barbarians is because they didn't speak their language, of course. And to them, the language that to the Greeks, everybody else's language sounded like bar, 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 bar. So they called them barbarians. That's literally where that comes from. And they walled themselves off. And so, to be fair about it, it wasn't just a Jewish problem. It was a people problem. And today it's not just this race or that race. And it's not just this group or that group. It's all of us. Every daggone single last one of us struggling. And so there's conflict between men and women. And there's conflict between black and white. And there's conflict between Muslim and Christian and Muslim and Muslim and Muslim and Muslim. And there's conflict between rich and poor. And there's conflict between Democrat and Republican. And there's conflict between young and old. And it's a universal struggle that we have. And when you begin to think about it, it can be despair.
you start thinking, we ought to be above this. Surely if we would educate ourselves enough, and if we would somehow let everybody know, and maybe shame everybody enough, if we would just shame everybody enough, then everybody would get over this whole problem of walling themselves off from other people. It's like a guy I heard a while back saying, I hate people who discriminate against people. And he didn't even think about what he was saying. Do you see how what a problem this is for us? Because as soon as we begin to think, I'm not like them, I don't have the same problems they do, we've walled ourselves off again. And we just repeated the age-old problem, the age-old issue. And when you get to thinking about it, this is such a quagmire for us as human beings that there really is, with all of our efforts, think about how much money has been spent trying to build walls, or build bridges between the races and tear down walls. And I'm not saying that's bad or wrong, trying to do that. But how much have our efforts changed the heart? A few weeks ago, a video went viral with a young college group that should be the enlightened among us. In fact, enlightened elite among us. On a school bus riding down the road, on a bus on some sort of a school trip, making racial slurs, for goodness sake. And everybody said, oh my goodness, how could they do that? Those terrible, terrible people, wall them off from the rest of us. End up doing the same thing they did. Do you see what happens here? What a quagmire. And I think the place we start right here is this, and the place we start, and I'll say the place we end, is this. Let the basis of your right standing before God do its work in bringing humility. There is only one answer here, folks, and that is humility before God. Paul starts this passage, therefore, remember who you were, remember your situation. He tells them, this thing that you have said makes you somehow superior people is made in the flesh by hands. He's already said it is by grace that you are saved through faith. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. The message to us, to all of us, is that we have so often take the very good things that God gives us, the gifts, the abilities, the things that God gives us to make us His masterpiece, and we let those very things be the things that keep us from other people, that wall us off from other people. It's like another guy I was talking with the other day, and He was talking about one of his friends who were having some medical problems. And here's how he said it. He said, you know, I think that they just kind of let themselves go. I work out. And right there I'm thinking, wow, you're a superior race. You work out. I'm so impressed by you. And I'm thinking, it's good to work out, right? Take care of the temple, take care of the body. But again, we find any way we possibly can to try to feel like we're up here and other people are down here. And the problem is, and here's the picture you can paint as we, okay, I'm this political party and not that political party, so I wall those people off. And I'm this race and not that race, so I wall those people off. And I'm this and not that, 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 and oh no. Here I stand, all by myself, excluded. Having essentially excluded me, myself, by my own sin. That's what sin does to us. It separates us not only from God, but it separates us from other people. The Jews had been given the law, and the law was intended to be a sign and a thing that set them apart, not so they could be somehow a superior race. But so that they could be a light to the Gentiles and the other nations around them. But you know, we even do the same thing sometimes with the Bible, don't we? And don't misunderstand me here, but here's the thing we do. We talk about those people who don't believe the Bible like we do. And automatically we're walling ourselves off instead of building bridges. And again, I'm not saying it's a bad thing to believe the Bible any more than I'm saying the Old Testament law was bad. But when those things become an occasion to separate us, they can become wrong, right? Let me say it this way. Listen very carefully to me, because I don't want you to misunderstand. I have no right ever to say, I'm right and you're wrong. I must instead say, he's right and we're both wrong. But by his grace, and only by his grace, I am with him who is right. And I have no place for pride in this, but I do know him to be right. I glory only in him. We're not saying there's no right and wrong here, like the philosophy of our day. That is a quagmire in itself. But what I understand is this, it's not me who's right. It's not my right. I have no claim on right. It is his right. And that leaves me no place for pride. Here. The Jews were told by God, it was not because you were more in number than any other people that the Lord set his love on you and chose you, for you were the fewest of all people. That might be a good word for us East Tennessee Christians. Deuteronomy 9, God says, not because of your righteousness or your uprightness of heart are you going to possess the land. Not at all. It was because God loved it. And God chose it to be a light to the nations. What an incredible message for you and for me. And Paul goes on and he says this, remember that you were at one time separated from Christ, alienated, or the word in some translations is the word excluded, from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise. And here, the word to us is this, let the reality of your right standing before God do its work of deepening your love for him. You remember the story of Jesus while he was invited by a Pharisee by the name of Simon. And the Pharisees were, you know, the thing that Jesus was so angry with the Pharisees about is that they built these walls. And they built them in such terrible ways and shut people away from God when they should have been the people who were pathways to God. And there was this Pharisee by the name of Simon, and he invited Jesus to come to his house. He really only invited Jesus to make sport of him, to kind of show him off. You know, I got this guy who can do miracles at my house today. And while they were sitting there, this guy who was so exclusivistic, this guy who was so walled off from everybody around him, having this party, the elite of the, you know, of the community were there, and this little lady slips in. And she was on the outside looking in, to say the least. She was, by the law, a terrible person. She had done terrible things. The law would certainly condemn her. And she slips in. She comes to the foot of Jesus. They would recline back in their seats instead of sitting like we do. And his feet would be out of the center. And here she comes to the center. And she takes perfume and she pours it on his feet. And then she weeps tears on his feet and wipes his feet with her hair. And Simon, this Pharisee, he was crazy with anger. If he knew who she was, he would never let this happen. And Jesus said this to him, therefore, Simon, I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little loves little. He wasn't saying, Simon, you have fewer sins than her. You just don't realize yours. She does. And because she understands the depth of her sin before God, she loves much. When you begin to see the separation that was ours before we came to Christ, when you begin to understand that the word separated, alienated, in hostility before God, describes who you were, then that changes your love for Him. It makes you, there's no room for pride. There's no place for saying, look what I've done. Because where pride is, love can never grow. When humility comes and we realize who we are before Him, then love blossoms. Don't you want to love Him more? I mean, even in our frailty as human beings, there's something inside of us that would say, oh, I wish I could love Him perfectly like He loves me. And we know that in our frailty we cannot come to that, but I'm going to tell you, the way your love is going to grow is when you begin to understand who you were versus who you are. That you were excluded, and now you have been included in Christ Jesus. The third thing, let the reality of your right standing before God do its work of bringing about racial reconciliation. You know, again, this is across races. There's no race that is superior to this than any other race. We're all equally as culpable, right? All of us discriminate. I grew up in here in East Tennessee. I heard the slurs. That was a part of the culture I grew up in. And thank God, somehow He put it in me that there was something wrong with that. But I was not any more above that than everybody else in some form or fashion. I've been in the back of a truck riding down the back roads of Haiti and heard people yelling, blonde, 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 white, white, white. It doesn't matter where you go. This is a human problem, not a racial problem. And so we begin to understand that God doesn't see people like we see them. Those things that are exterior and external, God doesn't see. God sees the heart. And you know what? Again, the maddening thing about this is just as soon as you think you're somehow above this, that's when you start looking down on the people who don't see it like you do. Right? And we start all over again. Again, I'll go back to point number one. Humility. Humility here. When Peter was up on the rooftop, and after we read of Acts chapter 10, he's up on the rooftop and he's praying, and God gives him a vision, and out of this vision there are all these unclean animals, these things that the Jews considered unclean, that come down on like sheets. And he's told, eat. And Peter says, no way, I'm a Jew. I've kept the law. I've never eaten those things. They're unclean, they're impure. Eat. Because what God has made clean, let no man count as unclean. And right after that, God, who has a great sense of humor, took Jewish to the gills, Peter, and said, I want you to go to the Gentiles' house and tell them about the gospel. And he goes, and there he meets a man by the name of Cornelius. And he speaks the gospel in obedience, even though it probably went against everything in him. And to his amazement, people in that household were saved. And the Holy Spirit fell down upon those people. And Peter was maybe more surprised than anybody in the place. And he says this. He says, Peter opened his mouth, which he was always good at, and said, truly, I understand that God shows no partiality. But in every nation, anyone who fears Him and does what is right is accepted to Him. You see, the walls come down in Christ Jesus between races. We see over and over that our God is not a racist God. At one point, Moses, when Moses married a Cushite woman, which means that she was African in descent. She was black, and Moses was Jewish, and Moses' sister and Aaron, his brother, made fun of him. They laughed at him about it, God let them have it. Because God will have none of these folks. And ultimately, when we, all this thing of walling ourselves off is displeasing to our God who created every single one of every single race in the image of God. And so, reconciliation in our relationships between the races is essential. But you know what? This is not an outside problem. We can't legislate this and make it work. That doesn't mean we shouldn't pass laws. It just means that the laws will never do what has to be done. You know what has to be done? The heart has to be changed. It's not a head issue, it's a heart issue. It is knowing what is right and applying it to how we act and how we think. And so, we must, as God's people, be about racial reconciliation. Number four, let the reality of your right standing before God do its work of opening your eyes and your hands to the poor and the hungry and the hurting. One of the greatest ways that we wall ourselves off is by socioeconomic classification, right? I am where I am because I worked hard. If they would just work as hard as I do, they would have what I have. Those people take advantage of people. That's why they've got all that stuff. And back and forth between rich and poor, there is disdain. The rich disdain the poor, who disdain the rich, because there's nothing more disdaining than being disdained by somebody. And what we begin to understand is that it is not our job to make that judgment. Our job is to do what God says. Part of the thing that we must be about in this community, that we have been placed in, is we must open our eyes and our hands to the hungry and to the poor and to the hurting. But at the same time, help people to understand that sometimes there are patterns that cause hunger, that cause poverty, that cause our pain. And then as much as possible, as God gives us the grace, help people to understand that. But it does absolutely no good for us just to point our finger and say, they'd just be like me. And so, let the reality of your right standing before God do its work of opening your eyes and your hands to the poor and the hungry and the hurting. I'll leave you to read two verses there in James chapter 2. And then, number 5, Paul closes out, verse 12 closes, having no hope and without God in the world. This just kind of caps off where we were before we came to Christ. And this is especially important to those of us who grew up in Christianity, who grew up in the church. I can never remember a time when I didn't know Jesus loves me, this I know, before the Bible tells me so. But at the same time, if I allow that to become a source of pride in my life so that I do not realize where I would be apart from Christ, all I'm doing is just building another wall. It is essential that those of us who grew up in the midst of Christianity understand what we have been spared from by the grace of God. I don't understand why God put some in Christian home and some not. We could spend forever trying to get that. I don't fully understand. But I know that I am not better than that person who's never heard the word Jesus Christ, the name Jesus Christ. All I am is graced by Him. It is not by works, lest anyone should boast. There is no way for me to say, look at my standing before God. That's why I am where I am. I was just as separated and alienated and excluded as anyone. And so here's the thing. Let the reality of your right standing before God do its work of deepening your compassion for the lost. When Jesus looked at the crowd, he saw them as distressed and dispirited, as sheep without a shepherd. I wonder what might be if Jesus had taken this approach. This is God's approach instead of the one he took. What if he said, if those people only knew why they're in the situation that they are, and if they would just do better, then this would be a good world, it would be a good place, we would all be hand in hand, arm in arm, all these walls would come down if they would just do it like I do it. Now, who had more occasion to say that than Jesus Christ, who was perfect? But he looked at the crowds as sheep without a shepherd and says, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. And then he said to his disciples, and that's us, folks. His disciples, that's us. And he's saying to us, make this your priority. The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. You know, as Christians who've been given the Bible, and have basically had the Bible placed in our hands, we don't even realize how much blood was shed just that we would have a Bible available to us. But as Christians who have the Bible in our hands, and we kind of get a little bit of a different view from the rest of humankind, again, not because we're somehow special, but because God has revealed it to us. He has helped us to see that this world is like a train headed for a broken track, and wreck is imminent. Listen to what Paul said. For you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying there's peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. We see that with that bird's eye view, the train headed down the track, it's going to wreck, and the people on the train do not know what lies ahead of them. Jesus said to us, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. That's what God has called us to. God has called us not to stand somehow in superiority over people who do not know the gospel and have not submitted to the gospel, but with compassion stand beside, hand in hand, with Jesus Christ, and with the gospel speak into their lives, because the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to the Jew and the Gentile. In God's eyes, there's no slave or free, Jew or Gentile, male or female. Those walls have all come down, and the gospel is for all people. Now, verse 13. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. And those two words, first of all, but now. Remember verse 4, but God. Now he's telling us this is what's happened to you as a people. But now. You were far away, but look where you are now. In Christ Jesus. You're no longer separated from God. And here we join with one another as a whole new humanity, as a whole new man, as a whole new people. And where is our place of residence? In Christ Jesus. And what is our claim? Christ Jesus. And nothing more and nothing less than Jesus Christ. Those of you who were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Number 6, let the reality of your right standing before God awaken praise in you for His glorious grace. those words far off. To be far from God is the worst condition that a human being can find themselves in. It's where Adam and Eve found themselves in the Garden of Eden. It's where those who looked up at the cross of Calvary and pointed, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" It's where every single human being sprinkled down through annals of time finds themselves far off. That was you. That was me. But you have been brought here by the blood of Jesus. Glorious grace. Matchless grace. Do you realize that even the ability to bow your head right now or to just breathe a prayer comes to you because you have been brought near? How precious is it to be able to go to God in prayer? You were separated from Him. You were far away. The writer of Hebrews says, "Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace and help to help in time of need." How is that possible? Because Jesus Christ shed His blood for you and for me. Our blood should have been shed. We have, this planet runs red with our hostilities toward one another. And yet God took away hostility and gave to us His friendship. And God took away exclusion and included us and brought us near. Think about this. Jesus Christ, who had perfect fellowship with the Father in glory, there upon the cross cries, my God, why have you forsaken me?" The one who had known absolutely nothing but perfect fellowship with the Father was separated from the Father in that moment for you and for me. He was separated that we might be brought near. And in Christ, do you understand the value of this? Oh, please, please, please. Don't miss this. You're included. You're included. And you no longer have to try to be somebody and wall everybody else off because you're somebody and they're not. But you already are somebody because Jesus shed His blood for you. And from the least of us to the greatest, from the person who might have done the worst of things, culturally speaking, that we could think of, to the one who just has sins of the mind and the heart. And we're all the same. It's all the same. It's all impurity and putrid before God. But He made us clean and whole by the blood of Christ. And in the blood of Jesus Christ, you have been brought. When they tried to marginalize Jesus, and the religious leaders of the time unknowingly condemned their own pride. Listen to what they said. They said they called Him a friend of sinners. May it be said about Beach Grove Church, friend of sinners. And the only way that's going to happen is if we have a clear assessment of who we are. The Apostle Paul, when he spoke of himself, said this, "For I was the least of the apostles unworthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. By the grace of God, I am what I am." At another point he says of himself, this saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. Paul saying, "You think you're a sinner? You should look at me. You should know me. And yet, by His grace, I am what I am." humility, deepening love for God, racial reconciliation, eyes open, hands extended to the poor and the hurting and the hungry, a deepened compassion for the lost, an awakening of praise for God's amazing grace. That sounds like heaven to me.